Can you tell me your name and your tribe?
Okay, my name is Kelly Tiger Jr. and I'm enrolled Seminole.
My name is Janet Johnson and I'm the development officer for the Grisso Mansion.
This is the window that I looked out and seen that little girl.
He said there's things that happen. He said that they can't explain.
Something was standing behind her and you can see it materialize.
I am a witness to seeing this little girl here back in 1989. And it's similar to all the descriptions that it said about the little girl at the Grisso.
William Edward Grisso, also known as Doc Grisso, came from Arkansas and made Seminole, Oklahoma his home in the early 1900s. Already a rancher and successful businessman, he also ran the Seminole drugstore and was the medical examiner, which is most likely how he received his nickname. Then oil was discovered and Seminole became a thriving city almost overnight, going from a population of 845 to nearly 30,000. Doc Grisso, along with many others in the surrounding areas, began obtaining land through mineral deeds and land purchases and became very wealthy. In 1926, Doc Grisso had a home constructed for his wife, Maggie Grisso, that overlooked the town of Seminole. When it was completed in 1928, it was definitely a sight to behold. But to some, it represented a time of greed and corruption.
My name is Janet Johnson, and I'm the development officer for the Grisso Mansion, and I'm also a Seminole Nation tribal member.
Can you tell me a little bit about the history of Grisso Mansion? A little bit about who Don Grisso is, or who he was?
Doc Grisso was known as a landowner and also an oil man, and he came over in the early 1900s and he acquired Indian oil leases.
How did he go about acquiring those leases?
My name is Kelly Tiger Jr. and I'm enrolled Seminole. This is a testament of my great-grandmother Louisa Tiger's legacy. But this is great-grandmother. Yeah, let me guess this. That was a picture. But this is my family. They had good times, but my dad said that money had a curse with it.
The money that Mr. Tiger spoke of was from Seminoles owning mineral rights off of their allotted lands when the oil boom hit.
My grandfather had wells on his individual allotment, so there was plenty for the family. And it was said that Grisso had a monopoly on oil leases for Indians. So he knew whose allotments were going to produce and whose weren't.
And the Greater Seminole oil field was the largest oil field in America, and it produced millions and millions of barrels. And you can imagine the tremendous wealth that was generated overnight and some of the sinister things that would have happened here in town. So you can imagine the different things that could have happened during that time with different land deals and such.
Where are we at now?
Okay, we're in the basement just on the east side of the ballroom. And this is the work areas of the servants. The Grisso family had 14 servants, and it said that they were all Seminole people.
Did they say how the servants would come to work here? How did Doc go about getting them? Or?
Well, Doc did own a drugstore, and so he would let people get credit. If you weren't able to pay him, sometimes he would let you work off that credit. And a lot of the servants that did live here were people that owed him money.
That subject of the Grisso has always been uneasy with our people because the wealth that he gained was, our people said, was through murder and deception. It's nothing that's discussed today, and probably nobody wants to say that, but I'll say it because I am a preacher. Right. And I will tell the truth.
I appreciate that.
Mm-hmm.
The Seminole Nation decided to purchase this oil boom mansion to tell both sides of the story, because not too many people know the impact of the oil boom to our people. Some of us became tremendously wealthy, and some of us lost everything. So we want to tell both sides of that, because it's the shared history of the entire community.
While history may never fully reveal the impact the oil boom had on the Seminole people, their stories of that mansion live on. On October 31st, 1955, Doc Grisso passed away, but some say his spirit, even perhaps the Seminole servants he owned, may remain in that home.
Ever since you've been working here, or you know, maybe before you started working, did you hear stories about the Grisso Mansion being haunted, or maybe having some paranormal activity here?
Well, when we first bought the property, we did talk to the previous owners, and although he didn't believe in paranormal or anything like that, but he did say that there was too many things that happened here that he just couldn't explain.
And the previous owners were the Hendersons, and didn't he ask him if it was haunted?
Yeah, he said there's things that happen. He said that they can't explain. He says, I'm not necessarily going to say it's actually haunted. He said, but there are things that happen that I can't explain. And he talked about lights being turned on and things being moved and, you know, just stuff like that.
There's a particular lamp, I guess, that's maybe in one of the sitting rooms that mm-hmm. might have a little bit of a story behind it.
Yeah, and the previous owners had that issue too with this lamp coming on. And they were a married couple, so it was only them two living here in the home. And they each thought the other one was leaving it on until they finally compared notes and realized it wasn't either one of them. But we didn't really believe it until we first purchased the mansion. And it did happen to us. Until one night, we did turn it on. And then as soon as we were walking back across the other side of the house, I looked back across and it was back on.
But yeah, this is the lamp.
That's the lamp that turns on by itself. So, did you tell them about what the Henderson said about the lamp?
Okay. It turns on by itself, or turns off too, or?
Just on.
Can we turn it off and then see if it comes back on later? It turns on by itself, or turns off too, or?
It isn't just on.
Can we turn it off? It turns on by itself, or turns off too, or?
It isn't just on.
Can we turn it off and then see if it comes back on later?
There's a young girl similar to the little girl that they see at the Grisso. Same one appears here in back of the church. This is the window that I looked out and seen that little girl in November, Saturday after Thanksgiving Day, 1995. She's never been seen in front of the church proper. It's always been back here. Nowhere else but back behind the church.
She was an Indian girl, right?
Indian girl, little Indian girl. It's what angers me. Nothing scares me. It angers me that these spirits can't rest and go home.
Okay. Can you tell me your name?
Eli is a bear.
And how old are you?
Eight.
And what What tribe are you?
Seminole.
Seminole?
Nation.
Okay. And I understand you have a story for us, right? Something that you saw in the ballroom?
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell me about that night? Tell me what happened?
Mm-hmm. I think it was a family thing where we had it on Christmas, and it's just me and my grandpa and my uncle downstairs, and my grandpa went to go play the piano, and my uncle was playing the guitar.
Mm-hmm.
And my uncle told me to take a picture, but I didn't know it was recording.
He hands her the phone, and she accidentally pushed the video record button, and in the transition from handing it over, she videoed from one shoulder to the other.
I was holding that camera like this, and then my uncle was gonna watch it because he said, oh, I just deleted it. But whenever he watched it, he saw somebody standing behind me, on this shoulder.
Something was standing behind her, and you can see it materialize out of thin air and then kind of walk over to the other side.
Following footage is actual video captured by Eliza Bear that December night.
Here it is. What are
you doing? You recorded this?
Yeah. Here it is.
What are you doing? You recorded this?
Yeah.
What did you think when you saw the video?
I got chills. And what even made me more creeped out was that this is the room where my daughter talks to something and says bye-bye Honka every time that we leave this room. And she's two. And then we also had another little boy that's not Indian that came out of this room and said, who's that little boy in the ballroom that's named Miko? And that was a very common name, and still is, for Seminole boys in our tribe. We are in the master bedroom of the Grisso Mansion, and this was Maggie Grisso's baby. She loved pink roses, and you can see it in the detail throughout the room. And this is also the most common room where people see a woman looking out the window. The previous owners also would be returning from town, and they would see a woman standing here. Or even visitors to their house would see a woman standing there.
Now we're in the kitchen of the Grisso Mansion, and I believe one of your coworkers experienced something in here.
And so I was gone all week, but I was due set to come back that evening. So my coworker Stephanie comes into the kitchen that morning for work, and she said every one of the cabinet doors were open because she had sent me a text and I was still in my meeting. And she said, are you back? And I was like, no. And I was like, why? And she said, you didn't come back last night or anything? I was like, no, I'm still in Tulsa. And so she sent me a picture, and every one of the cabinet doors were open.
Because it's all fun to talk about the ghost and everything, but whenever you actually see something like that,
yeah,
in front of you, it's kind of like, let's just move on and try to just keep everybody safe. Because we don't know whether they're happy or sad or, you know, they haven't done anything violent to us. But I don't want to push it.
So later that evening, I got a call from the alarm company that one of the alarms was being triggered here in the mansion. And so I called the police by then, because if nobody's here, then we assume somebody's broken in.
Right.
So when I called the police, they said, well, which door was triggered? Which one was broken into? So I called the alarm company, and they said it was an internal motion sensor that was triggered. And so when Stephanie and Chad had gotten here, and all of the doors were locked, and so when they came back in, none of the normal things set it off.
That's how our people believe when we see spirits. It's a bad omen. Sometimes it's a good omen. They show themselves to us to let us know they're okay. But in a situation like here, a situation at the Grisso, or some bad events, those spirits tend to hover around, and things are so bad that our people says that their spirit can't go past to go home, that they stay behind and then they're stuck here. I believe that. And like I said, I am a witness to seeing this little girl here. And it's similar to all the descriptions that is said about the little girl at the Grisso.
Doc Grisso died on Halloween and Maggie Grisso died on October 30th. So we don't know if that has something to do with it as well. But I feel like the spirits here are tribal, or either Maggie, who really had her heart in this home. So, and we feel like that they're glad that we're here to preserve the integrity of the mansion.
What's your final thoughts? Do you think that the mansion is haunted?
But there's too many unexplained things here to not say that there's something here.
The Native American Paranormal Project has been invited to the Grisso Mansion. This is their footage.
When you guys walked into the mansion for the very first time, can you tell me a little bit about your initial thoughts, the whole grand structure of it?
I just thought it was elegant.
Okay.
I was impressed.
It was like she said, it was elegant, taken care of, well-groomed. Everything looked good when we pulled up there.
It was a real nice place. I really liked how they decorated it.
The female side of me was coming out and wanted to go room to room and see how it was decorated.
Who decorated this place?
And everything, you know. And I mean, because, you know, the furniture is, you know, very nice furniture, right. and everything. I think that was, you know, what I was wanting to check out first.
And on top of that, going into it, you knew about the history of it and some of the paranormal stories that came with the mansion. Did you feel a presence right away?
Yeah, as soon as I walked in, it's just like walking in from the heat into the cold air, like the heat to the air conditioner, you know, that's how much of a difference, you know. As soon as I came in, it felt like, you know, I had something was always watching me.
Have you ever felt when you're self-conscious, when you think everybody's looking at you, when you walk into somewhere where you've never been? That's how I felt when I walked in there.
And, you know, I never shook that all night. All night, everywhere we went, I just had that feeling of somebody watching me.
You know, other than all the other paranormal investigations that we've done, you know, we know what we're going into. That is the first time I really walked into somewhere feeling like, you know, like, hey, it's about ready to happen right now.
Tell me your name and your tribe.
Steve Jacob, Chutta.
Marina McCain, Bronaw, Creek and Seminole, Kiowa Ponca.
John Factor, Seminole, Kiowa, Comanche, and Caddo.
My name is Marcus Keese, IMC, Free Joe, Chaho, Jifkados. I'm Pawnee and Seminole.
I'm Dee Dee Dakota, Chickasaw, Sistan Wapaton, Oyate.
Dear God, we just thank you for this opportunity once again to come together to do another paranormal session. And we just ask that you just protect this.
Amen. Amen. Which are phones? Looks like you hit the recording.
Yeah.
Alrighty.
Alright.
Okay, tell me what you're about to do, Steve.
Putting up a microphone. This is a very sensitive microphone. We use it to pick up voices when they're off. And I got my camera set up here. We'll see what we catch today here. We're getting ready to push record. We're just going to let it run while we're upstairs. See what we can get.
Unfortunately, the recordings turned out to be inconclusive. However, the team would get better results from the EVP sessions.
Where are we headed now, Dee Dee?
We are going into the Doc Grisso's bedroom. This would be the, I guess, the master bedroom. Hello? Is anyone in here in Doc Grisso's room? Maggie, are you here in this bedroom? This is a pretty bedroom.
We are now entering the ballroom.
I'm gonna set this on the table.
Okay.
And I'm gonna place this here
in the original basement area of the ballroom. And if spirits want to say anything, Miko, if you're here, you can talk into this, sweetie. I'm gonna put it right here.
Okay, we're in the music room. I'm gonna sit on this antique, creepy chair. I'm gonna see if we can get anything out of this music room. Apparently, this piano plays, and we want to see if we can get something. Who stays in this music room? Michidaya, can you play the piano right now? What's your name? Where are you? Where are you in this house?
Somebody is here. Turn the flashlight on. Yes, the thing about the mirrors was I didn't want to look into the mirrors because I didn't know what I was going to see coming back. The house is full of mirrors. I'm going to put it over here on this chair over here. And when we went into that room, there was big mirrors in there. And I kind of kept my head down as I walked through there and tried to set up the camera. And then we got our place in the middle of the room. And I got my way to where I wouldn't have to look at a mirror because I didn't want to see what would be looking back.
A few minutes into their EVP session, they would capture the first EVP of the night. It was about one of the mirrors.
I'm going to put it over here on this chair over here. If you don't like being close to electronic equipment. I'm going to put it over here on this chair over here. If you don't like being close to electronic equipment.
I think it's, yeah, I heard something.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about when the investigation started. Where did you go for your first assignment?
Our first assignment was the ballroom and the game room and the extension of the game room. In the ballroom, you know, when we had the doors open, you know, it wasn't too bad. Or, you know, whenever we turned the light off and close the door. I didn't really get much of a vibe in there, but you know, I still had that feeling that something was watching me. We might need the light just to be able to see if anything.
I'm gonna put it in the middle.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. I want to set this somewhere though, like.
My name is Marina, and this is John. If there's any spirits in here that would like to say something, could you make your presence known?
What kind of question did you ask out there, down there?
We just asked about the boy named Miko. You know, we asked him questions, you know, seeing if he wanted to come out. Miko, are you here with us? We heard you'd like to play down here. I rolled a quarter across the floor, you know, see if he would stop it, you know, or something. You want to stop the coin for us? Try one more time and see if you stop it. Stop the coin for me from spinning. You know, he didn't react to anything that we did. He didn't answer any questions that we asked him.
We're leaving the ballroom. We tried to provoke Miko to come out and talk to us, and we definitely feel him in here, but he didn't make any physical sounds for our ears to hear, so.
We're gonna go on to the next room now.
Maybe taking a small glance into the other world to see if that other world has anything it wants to tell us in this time that we live in. Whether it be from him, Doc Grisso, and his anger and his hatred towards Native people, or maybe it's the ones who suffered, who were Native people alive during his time, who suffered the wrath and the vengeance of him, and they couldn't do anything about it back then. They couldn't protect themselves. So we're here.
After Keese wraps up his EVP session in the sitting room, he reviews the audio. He wasn't alone.
Nah, that's not you. That's like, that's what it sounds like. If you listen to it real closely, it's like a,
I did. But you know, I didn't answer like that.
You know what? It sounds like a dog, but it's not a dog. It's like a grunt. It's like a, cause you can hear it. You can hear it go. It like does a two steps. Somebody here?
Yeah.
Sounds like a.
Even I know now when I ask questions, I do it one at a time instead of doing it twice.
It's not a voice.
Yeah, it's raising itself up.
It's like a grunt. It's like a grunt. It's like a. That's what it sounds like.
That wasn't the only voice recorded.
Okay, tell me what you just found on your recorder.
Okay, the second part of that segment of recording, I was in the same room. I had said, on the second part, I had said, we're in your home. I said, we're in your home. And then it sounded like softly you could hear, over here. And then it got louder, and it said, over here. And then it said, either die or nine. I don't know. I can't really make it out because it's soft. But you can hear it. You know, it's audible. It's a woman's voice. So, yeah.
Let's go and play it.
And we're going to play it.
We're in your home.
We're in your home.
Didi, when we was in the when you guys were in Doc's bedroom, and you sat in the part of the room where Maggie has been known to be seen.
Right.
Did you feel anything different when you sat there?
Was this once your bedroom?
Mr. Jotty.
I did it, and you know, I purposely did that to try to bring her out because, you know, we had been told that she doesn't like anybody sitting in her sitting place.
Margaret, we're gonna leave. Give this place back to you. Bye.
We're coming out of that and fixing to go into the kids' room, which is the end. You know, it's at the end of the hallway, and there's some stairs by it. And we distinctively heard like children laughing.
And it was late at night, so there couldn't be no neighborhood kids outside right. running around. It was during the middle of the week. And, you know, you could hear that, yeah. I don't know what that was, but I heard it.
This is the children's room on the second floor of the Grisso Mansion.
I'll sit on this bed. Miko, are you in here, Miko? Is this your room, Miko? Remember, get corners.
You know, as we walk from the ballroom, it's a hall, small hall, that we had to walk down. I just got that feeling that any minute something was gonna run up and grab me from behind. That's how I literally felt all night.
Pass this camera. Can you do it again?
Can you see that? Sorry. Ooh, what was that? Oh, okay. I was like, what is that? But it's the lighting off, the reflection off of it.
All right, John, let me know what your thoughts were about y'all's EVP sessions down here.
I kept hearing stuff in this room, and something's here, I know.
Possibly could have captured a lot of audio. Definitely can feel it very heavy down here. Smell it, smell perfumes. It was so strong that it kind of is kind of giving me a headache.
You know, you just tell that somebody was in there with us.
Definitely could feel it really heavy in this room. I think more than out of all the rooms that we went to down here, I could feel it in this one.
I know we're not alone.
Okay, we are in the children's room. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna walk around this room and see if I feel anything. I think there's something outside. There was something outside earlier. It's not good.
We are now going downstairs of the Grisso Mansion into the ballroom and game room.
The history of the mansion, how it kind of came into being, there's been stories been passed down from tribal members about Doc Grisso and his practices and how he got his wealth and how he acquired the land, but nothing's ever been documented. Tell me your thoughts about that part of it.
Well, it just happened with every tribe, you know. They were natives were thought as second-class citizens, you know. They weren't even citizens of the United States till 1910, so, you know, why were they going to take care of them when they got this piece of land with all these mineral rights on them, which, you know, oil, which would bring, money brings out the worst in people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's just stories everywhere within every tribe.
Right. Do you believe that this did go on back then, though?
Yeah, I believe it is, because, I mean, prior to this investigation, I did a little bit of reading about different other tribal members that the same thing happened to them.
Right.
It went on for a long time.
As the investigation comes to an end, the team would gather in the sitting room for one last EVP session. Keith would head to the basement.
To the catacombs of the basement. They say things are down there. Here we are. As you can see, we have what looks like very elk lodges, whatever you call it, elk lodge style, or mason, Freemason style. Maybe this is where they would sit. They say sometimes this piano will play, and here's what I'm gonna do. You see me there?
Where are we gonna be at?
Okay. So we're here in the basement of the Grisso Mansion.
And the last session of the night was kind of a group session. I think a lot of the team members felt like there was some activity in that same room you just got to talking about.
And the sitting room is where Doc Grisso supposedly sat and read in a certain chair, and the lamp comes on, and it comes on by itself.
And if you're here, can you please tell us your name? And if you're here, can you please tell us your name?
Seconds later, a shadow appears to climb out of the chair.
Can you
turn your left on. Turn your left on.
I don't have that, the sharp pain in my head, because if this is a bad place, then I would have that. So what that tells me is it tells me that they're either not allowed to come in here because I'm in here. And so, with that being said, I'm gonna walk around and see how I feel in this place. As we tell this story to the people, are you afraid of us? You must be afraid of us, because we know now what they didn't know a long time ago. This is where the video was?
It was right there.
Okay.
So that Miko is known to be down here a lot. So, and he's a playful spirit, so maybe play on that a little bit.
Shabani. Shabani, are you here? Is that who you are? How old are you? Shabani, what's your name? What clan are you? Well, in your world, be good. Okay, we're here in the game room extension. We're gonna see if we can... I can hear something. Is anybody in here? Shabani, are you in here? Can you show us? Can you move something?
Keith would begin to hear faint voices. The recordings captured a man's voice.
Who was that? Who was that? Say it again. Who was that? Say it again. Who was that? Say it again. Maru. May your journey be good. Maru. Good on.
Are we bothering you? Does it bother you that we're sitting in your family room? We're all Indian here. Does it bother you that we're sitting in your family room?
Keys, can you tell us what we're doing?
Yeah, we're just smoking off right now. So we don't carry anything with us, take it back home, or let it, so we don't let it allow it to affect our livelihood, our vehicles, our homes, our family. And, you know, because what we do here is just a good thing, telling a story, so.
sage right here is to purify. That's what they use sage for, purify that sweet grass for that goodness, you know, that good spirit like that. So it's important, you know, we're out here having fun, you know, having a good time, you know, but it's always important to acknowledge, you know, the ceremonial ways. So
any final thoughts about Grisso Mansion?
It's a beautiful place, you know, I mean, I wouldn't want to be there alone, but it's haunted and something's there, and it's not a happy feeling there.
Like I said, I was just ready for this whole thing to be over with that night at the Grisso Mansion.
Would you want to go back?
With a lot of people.
What paper would you send to the
family?
You know.
Those had big Mexican. Oh, shit, just get
the fuck out of me. Mark! Why don't you like Indian women? Because we're beautiful.
Can you take a shower here?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
you can.
I don't know, I ain't never tried.
Go ahead, Dee Dee, we'll be upstairs.
Yeah. I didn't have time to think of shower today.
I don't
care. Well, that's the game room. Where's the kitchen at?
My name is Janet Johnson, and I'm the development officer. Start over. Prepared notes and realized it wasn't either one of them. So what they did was turn the lamp off. When...
You all right? Hang on.
Yeah. But we didn't really believe it.
We just kept.
It was on. So they kind of just left it unplugged. Not because they were scared, but because they didn't want to waste their electricity.
Yeah, that's yours.
No, it's not. I didn't put perfume on.
It must be your deodorant.
She don't wear deodorant.
Oh, that's a B.O.
My natural smell.
I keep smelling bologna.
Or Kawa guy. Not helping her out. Or Kawa guy's not evening it up.
Come on, Dad.
Okay.
No, I'm